Hi, I'm Selectman Sean Askham, and welcome back to another edition of Community Conversations. As always, I'm joined by my fellow Selectman, Selectman Mike Paine, Selectman Cheryl Cook, and we're honored to have current Board of Ed member and State Rep candidate Lydia Tedone here with us today. Lydia, now you've got an impressive resume, and go with me, make sure I get them all, but you are the immediate past chairman of the Board of Ed here locally in town.
Yes.
In Simsbury. You are the immediate past president of CABE.
Yes.
Correct. And you are also
past chair of CREC,
okay.
But I do sit on those two boards, and I am a board member on National School Board Association based in Washington, D.C.
So what do you do in your free time?
Maybe we should unwind some of those acronyms. Why don't we tell the people at home what
absolutely.
CABE is?
Absolutely. CABE is Connecticut Association of Boards of Education.
Yep.
CREC is Capital Region Education Council, and as I mentioned before, NSBA is National School Board Association.
So to say you're passionate about education would be probably an understatement, right?
Very much. Mm-hmm. Very much so.
Obviously, and you've been on the Board of Ed for a long time now.
Yep. At least 20 years.
20 years. I wasn't going to date you, but okay.
I can do that.
And obviously, you've seen a lot of change and a lot of influence in this community, and we obviously appreciate that service,
thank you
for that.
Thank you.
So give us a little more about your background. Besides your service on the educational side, what else do you like to do? What do you get involved in?
Well, I like to get involved, obviously, in politics, but I also like to get involved in a lot of organizations. I belong to Seroptimus of the Farmington Valley, which is a service organization benefiting women and girls throughout the area and also internationally. So that also is a big piece of my life, is giving back to community in other ways. I'm also a member of the Chamber,
yep.
So I partake in a lot of their activities and a lot of the activities that go on in town. I enjoy being there. My family and I have grown up in Simsbury for 30 years. And this is our home, our community,
right.
And we feel very part of it.
Absolutely.
And you and your husband are very involved in
a number of things. Yes,
yeah.
Yes, absolutely. So that is what we do, I do in my spare time.
So that's
time.
That's the end of the free time there. So. Excellent. Well, that sounds excellent. So obviously you were part of the budget process recently, as were we. So
yes,
we're thankful that the Board of Finance finally, after much back and forth, passed both the Board of Education budget and the Board of Selectmen budget, and it's going on to referendum on June 7th. So start on the Selectmen side, then we'll move to the Board of Education side quickly, because obviously you're the bigger piece of it. But what were your thoughts, Mike and Sherry, just from the public hearing and you know what we ultimately came out with?
I was pleased with what we ultimately came out with. Yep. I was more pleased with what we initially came out with, but then the state pulled back a bunch of money.
Right.
And unfortunately, because we have to put forward a balanced budget, that meant, okay, we wanted to do these things, how are we going to do them?
Mm-hmm.
And in several cases, we actually had things that, because of the timeline to get them accomplished over the summer, we actually had to fund ahead of time the field at the high school needed to get redone.
Right.
We the town had to actually pay cash to do that.
Right.
And we had a program with our streetlights that we will find out tonight if it actually happened.
Right, that's right.
But how we were going to do that, and was actually the town purchasing the streetlights and changing them from regular streetlights to LEDs. But a lot of good programs, and again, some great dialogue at the Board of Selectmen, at the Board of Finance, and I was really very proud and pleased with what we ultimately came out with.
Well, and just to take a step back a little further, you know, when we started the budget process, you know, the first selectman presented her budget, and, you know, it was a lean budget. It had a lot of really good things in it, but as a board, you know, we had some great conversations and discussions on both sides of the aisle about where we could trim that down and where we could preserve our priorities, you know, for the town, and we actually came in a little lower than we thought, and, you know, in an effort to, you know, protect the taxpayers. And, you know, like I said, they were all good suggestions, you know, but unlike the state, we had to make our hard choices.
Right, right.
And I think we did that in a very bipartisan way.
Yeah, we did.
And again, I mean, the contrast between our budget process, even though, you know, on a much smaller level, and what happened at the state was just, it's night and day.
It really is.
You know, you have to wonder why can't we have a civil conversation?
Well, and that's an excellent segue into the Board of Ed side, because you folks are the most organized, thoughtful group. I mean, I think we do well, and you guys do it even better from the Board of Ed side.
Here, here.
Well, thank you. I think we work very hard, very diligently on our budget. We start our budget process really, it's almost all year, but in November, and we work on the budget continuously, and we're always looking for continuous improvement programs, and even though we have declining enrollment, and but that also is part and parcel to the fine education system that we still have to continue for the town of Simsbury.
Right.
So our budget process basically starts as soon as the budget of this year passes, and I think it's the hard work of the superintendent, the central office, the principals, and the Board of Education in the communication process, and the communication process within and also within the community, which is very crucial in order to craft a budget, to have a budget passed, to be a working document and budget for the following school year.
Absolutely, and I continue to be impressed. You know, for several years running, the Board of Education has delivered below 2%. I think you're at 1.75 this year again.
Yes, we are.
And to put that in context, I mean, 1.75, well, wait a minute, that's an increase. Well, let's take a step back. There are teacher contracts that are guaranteed. There are obligations that we have to fund.
Yes.
And, you know, in the reality of binding arbitration and honoring our contracts, you know, costs do go up. Mm-hmm. The fact that your board is able, and with your leadership in the past, is able to keep the increase below the wage increases, which is our largest driver, really is a testament, I think, to the thoughtfulness and thorough nature that you folks do on your budgeting side. I mean, to say you get down to the classroom level, I don't think is an exaggeration from your budget side. You really, you know where every dollar is going.
We do.
In every building.
We do. And when we talk about transparency in the budget process, this Board of Education here in Simsbury is very transparent.
Right.
Transparent. Mm-hmm. And also very communicable about the whole budget process and line items.
Absolutely.
And we take it very, very seriously and very carefully as we have the constant communication throughout the budget workshops.
Right. Right. And I think, as you know, there are certain items in the Board of Ed budget that depend on what the state is going to do in a lot of different areas for transportation, special education, non-public schools, all those things that we have to do by law. And
absolutely,
we're not getting the support that we need from
And I also will put in the budget process is that there are the state mandates that affect us, you all know well. And I was recently at a coalition meeting that we have, and there are over 50 mandates involving public education within every district in Connecticut. So these are mandates that are unfunded mandates that we still are grasping and grappling with to how to fund them within our districts.
Right.
And they affect everything that happens right down to each individual student.
Right. And even when the state cuts ECS funds, they do not stop on the mandate train.
They do not. Yeah. So I think and I think we were successful this year on behalf of CABE and behalf of our advocacy in public education to express our concerns to the legislature about no new mandates because we as districts and municipalities still have the responsibility to fund those mandates that are already passed by legislature in law.
So switch gears to that for a second, Lydia, because you've spent a significant amount of time down at the legislature.
Yes, I have.
Lobbying.
Testifying. Yes,
working with folks on both sides of the aisle to make sure that education is taken care of and that funding is there. So talk a little bit about that experience.
Yes, in particular in the education area, I do spend quite a bit of time, as you alluded to, Sean, in the advocacy, the grassroots level with Education Committee, Appropriations Committee, other legislators about the state of education in public education in Connecticut. And I represent Simsbury and my other colleagues that are there on the board, the K board and CREC board represent their districts. So we are very well represented from urban, suburban, small, and rural districts. We represent the four corners of the state. We represent 161 school districts when we are there. And I have testified on behalf of education to the legislature on particular bills and amendments that were coming forward during the legislative process, and we have been very successful in telling our story and conveying to the legislators about the public education scenario and situation that's going on in Connecticut.
Right. I personally think that's why I'm one of the main reasons I'm so excited to see you run for statewide office, because I've seen you affect change at the state level.
Thank you.
You know, as a volunteer, and you know, trying to go there now as an elected official and really getting into the room and affecting changes is something mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to seeing you in action with. So that'll be exciting to do for sure.
Thank you. And I think that ability to, as you said, to talk to people on both sides of the aisle and to have legislators look at the consequences of their actions, because I think that's something that we have been missing.
Absolutely.
You know,
they
think they have this great idea, but nobody figures out what the downstream costs are going to be to the municipalities, to the school systems, you know, to the citizens. And it's, you know, we've seen this year as they've sort of gone back and forth on the car tax, you know, the municipalities have to have a number. And, you know, first we thought it was 32, then it's not, then it's, you know, then we're getting reimbursed, then we're not. It's a very difficult process.
It's the unintended consequences and the ramifications of that, that most people, when you talk to them and explain to them, well, if you do this, here's what happens down here, they don't take the time to do that. They just dig in their heels. And it may be a good idea or a bad idea, but they need to understand the totality of the impact of that. I'm sure every single mandate was started with good intentions.
But
not understanding where it was going to go and how it was going to impact everything.
Absolutely. Yeah. And as many mandates do start in other things, it may start by just one concern of a resident in a particular area in a particular town.
Right.
Unfortunately, that one concern of that particular resident constituent may be applicable to that particular municipality, not to the totality of municipalities or school districts. That is one area that when as you had mentioned, looking at the whole picture, you really have to look at everything there particular this year.
Well, I mean, Cheryl, you made the comment, and Lydia, I think you're uniquely positioned for it. I mean, there's simply not enough discussion and collaboration between the two parties going on, whether you're Republican or Democrat. Obviously, we're Republicans. But, you know, education is not a partisan issue.
Issue.
It's a public obligation. And we've all, as public servants, taken that obligation. And I think folks have lost their way, especially folks that have been in charge for 36 years. And again, you know, it's, I think we need to elect folks on both sides of the aisle, quite honestly, but especially the folks sitting here that are willing to have the conversation with people from both parties. Because it's not just about dollars and cents. It's not just about mandates or not, right? It's about how are we going to educate our children? And I'm far more akin to that now that Eleanor is nine.
Now that you have one.
Yes.
Absolutely.
But,
now's the time, right?
It's exciting. It's important to focus on that. So talk about your experience on the Board of Ed and how you've kind of build bridges and what you think you can bring there.
It's important that that you build bridges, that you learn the art of compromise also, the art of listening and the art of negotiating.
Right.
And you also have to give and pull on certain areas. And I think why we have been very successful in the Board of Education here in Simsbury for longer than I've been on the board, and there are many great mentors of that have come before me that I consider as mentors, that have worked very hard to make this school system and number one A-class school system in the state of Connecticut, in the country. And I hear that all the time, and wherever I am. And yes, we are ranked very high in Nietzsche and Money Magazine and a number of publications. And that says very much about the town. That says very much about the support. That says very much about, you know, why people choose to come here, move here, educate their children, be take part in all the activities that are here in town. But I think the successful a successful board is very important. We are a very successful board. We do not let politics enter into our decision making or agenda items or our votes. We are very strategic. We're a very astute board. I've hired the right superintendent, and he has been here going on year five, and that makes a big difference when you have that leadership at the top, that CEO at the top, and you have a board that works well together. Then that makes all the difference in the world, because that means that you have a very well-oiled run machine called a public school system. And this Board of Education is very well known throughout the state of Connecticut for who we are and for what we do.
Agreed.
I'm sure on the state level you've seen what happens when boards do not function
as
well as ours, because there are a lot of towns that have boards that have been full of conflict and
all sorts of issues. Right? They lose their way.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I think you see the effects of that in their school systems too.
Absolutely, yeah. and in the town. And I think a big piece of what I have been doing for 20 years in the education arena, mm-hmm. it's local, state, and national. I think I can do at the state level in the state legislature, and mm-hmm. we talk about structural changes and pay close attention to policy changes. I mean, this is one area that this year has been overlooked in the state legislature, and there are many areas that have been passed in this budget and in the state legislature that they're going to have to concentrate on to next year. So many things maybe were not passed this year will be brought forward next year, right. And the year will just move very quickly.
I think one of the most frustrating things for us, because we are a very transparent board also, mm-hmm. you know, we have a board in place now that works very well together. All six of us have collaborated on many things, and we're very proud of that. But the lack of transparency at the state level and the exclusion of one party over another in the whole budget process has shown us, you know, and the result is a fiscal mess. And,
you know,
that is the frustration of...
I continue to be baffled by that, again, you know, there are folks elected from both sides of the aisle with business experience and practical mm-hmm. experience and educational experience. And again, the Republican Party, once again, not a single amendment was considered, not a single idea was put in. It was all Dan Malloy
and
our party was dragged along, and the governor actually agreed with our party for a while in the paper there until it didn't suit him anymore. And again, nobody likes Dan Malloy right now. I get that, but it's shocking.
Well, it's not that you have to agree. You have to at least talk.
Right.
Have to be able.
Not a single
to
amendment. I mean, you mean to tell me that, you know, in the last 10 years, not a single Republican had an idea worthy mm-hmm. of a vote from a Democratic rep or senator?
That's the point that really bothers me.
Yeah.
I refuse to believe that only one particular party had any good ideas for the state.
Yeah.
I refuse to believe that not one person had not one idea that to put forth, even if only to start a discussion.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I actually, mm-hmm. even though the budget process for our Board of Selectmen is incredibly intense, the discussions are great. And everybody looks at stuff a little differently, but we talk it through, and we don't always agree, but we talk it through. And I've always kind of looked at it that it's my job to educate everybody what I'm thinking and how I'm thinking.
Absolutely.
And give them the benefit of a different perspective, whether it's good or bad or right or wrong. Mm-hmm. You have that discussion, and mm-hmm. then the idea is to get to a better place.
Right.
And you learn from the other point of view.
Right.
I mean, I always
if you're willing to listen, yes.
That's right.
The four of us obviously are, yes.
You know, we talk about like the subcommittees we sit on and stuff, and I always walk out of those committee meetings thinking, wow, I just learned something I didn't know before.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't matter who told me, whatever it is, it's a benefit because now we can all work on something, you know, useful.
I think, you know, that's why Simsbury really does, I mean, we matter anyway, but we really do matter in terms of the math down at the legislature. We already have Senator Whitcoser, the 8th. They need to flip 5 seats to at least even out the mm-hmm. Senate and change the majority. On the rep side, I mean, Simsbury very much does matter because, quite honestly, for the last, I believe, 8 years, mm-hmm. our vote on the budget has not counted.
No.
Mm-hmm. I don't believe that any of our reps in the past 8 years have actually voted for a budget, or if they voted for a Republican amendment. They voted for nothing, which is, you know, I know how it gets written up in the paper and spun, but... Mm-hmm. You need to take a stand on something and be for something down there, and that's why I'm excited again to see you running.
Right, and I think also this is an exciting time for me to jump into this arena because, as you know, we have 21 plus legislators either resigning or retiring after
mm-hmm. it's a lot of turnover.
This legislative session, so there will be a lot of turnover. With that being said, Republicans need only 12 seats to take the General Assembly again.
Right.
So that is very, very important. That is something that is embedded in my mantra, in my thinking, and also my other colleagues that are entering into mm-hmm. the race throughout Connecticut. So we have an opportunity to possibly take the legislature because next year will be another year. It will be a new year. But with that being said, we are still going mm-hmm. to be facing the fiscal crisis and challenges the policy changes. Right. We need structural, long-term structural mm-hmm. changes within the state of Connecticut that we operate in. We need to talk about the businesses, not right. only attracting new businesses that to Connecticut, right. but keeping those businesses, corporations, and manufacturing yeah. Yeah. in Connecticut that we have.
Right.
So there are a lot of areas and arenas that we need to continually focus on to address more so than they have been addressed in the past.
Right.
Because at the end of the day, they ultimately, even though all politics are local, mm-hmm. it affects every school district, every municipality
right.
within the state of Connecticut.
Mm-hmm. And I think folks need to just make sure they understand when the Republicans are, and our party is looking to have a more balanced legislature, it's not to attain power for the sake of power. That's the only way to get a discussion with the governor. To
right.
get ideas on the mm-hmm. table, because there has to be compromise.
Absolutely.
There will not, right. nothing will pass, because if the legislature passes it on the Republican side and the governor vetoes it, nothing will pass.
Nothing will happen.
So they're going to, you know, mm-hmm. when you're down there and everyone else, Republicans and Democrats with Daniel Malloy, are going to have to get in a room and agree on something, which mm-hmm. I think will be better for the state.
Yeah.
Honestly, because then you're bringing a whole set of ideals that have been excluded for years.
Well, I think collaboration has right. to be better.
It's served our town well for a long
party,
time.
You know,
it does. It's
and one again, party rule has
yeah.
not worked.
Yeah.
I mean,
well,
we see the effects of that every day.
Right. And that's not an indictment on any of the individuals that serve down there locally from any
right.
party. It's a reality
it's really
of how
just one
it's
party.
A reality of how the math works.
Right.
It's, yeah.
It's
you know,
the system that really has a problem where one particular group has all the power and can
right.
do whatever they want. It is not healthy, and I honestly believe in my heart that that's part of the reason we are at the crossroads we're at now, because I do believe we're at the crossroads.
This
Agreed.
Is it, and this is a really poignant year. This is
mm-hmm.
the year. This is all the fiscal situations and the crises that you have seen, you know,
mm-hmm.
that have been happening throughout the year in the state of Connecticut, and it just wasn't this year. It's years
yeah.
of mismanagement, right. years of misgoverning that are leading up
mm-hmm.
to this. But this is very emblematic of the crisis and the change that is happening
right.
and
right.
what is going on. And,
right.
and you know, whether it be businesses, whether it be education, whether it
mm-hmm.
be other areas of social services or other areas that are being cut out of the budget
mm-hmm.
or layoffs that are happening as we speak.
Mm-hmm.
These are a lot of things that we have not had
right.
seen in the past years and past legislative actions, but that are happening now.
Yeah. And I think it's really not to throw blame.
No, it's really not.
And
no.
I think that, you know, the discussion that,
mm-hmm.
oh, this happened because, you know, there was a governor 10 years ago who did this or that is not productive. No, you know, talking about what past governors did or the current governor, quite frankly, doesn't move the conversation forward.
Right.
I mean, we still have a budget that has a deficit for this
Absolutely.
Year. We still have deficits coming next year.
Right.
And that doesn't help us.
Right.
You know, what we need is someone like you who can, you
right.
know, start the conversation and work on it.
Right. And that's a, you know, collaboration, compromise,
mm-hmm.
as I said, listening skills, negotiating, really understanding, rolling up my sleeves,
right.
You know, I have a good vision of what is going on. I have been at the Capitol. I have, in fact, many legislators think that I am already there. and I have a very good relationship with, you know, legislators and lobbyists
yep.
that are there, yep. and also yep. Governor Malloy. I know him also.
Just don't say that too loud, though.
But we do have conversation.
You do.
We do have I can admit that.
But that's okay.
I can admit that we
that's
have very good, and it's a very good, and
I
I'm very
proof
proud of
what you're talking about.
Because we
yeah. mm-hmm.
because
exactly.
we do have conversation, and we may agree to disagree, but we have had, you know, great conversation, and he has been very, very supportive of the public education in the past 4 years, and in particular with the education reform, and I do have his ear, especially when it comes to districts like mine that I will always stand up first and foremost for, and the students and the staff and the parents of this town that I have lived here for 30 years and
mm-hmm.
so love and,
exactly.
and will continue to.
Yep.
So that is a mm-hmm. That is a very good, you know.
Well, we are a unique district in that you only have one town to represent,
right.
And
yes.
you get to focus all of your attention on
absolutely
on what and, what Simsbury needs.
Absolutely, and keep it the way it is. We do like when we are headlined in publications and magazines across the country, and mm-hmm. and I'm very proud when I travel across the country and at visiting other colleagues and things,
right.
and I mention Simsbury, Connecticut, and they have read about this,
oh, yes.
and so it does make me very proud.
Oh, and we just won an award for our music and arts program.
Yes,
didn't we?
Did.
Yes, we did.
We did recently, so that was also
another national recognition.
Absolutely,
for,
that was wonderful. So very, very proud. Very, mm-hmm. very proud of our school system, as I am of the town of Simsbury.
Absolutely.
And very happy to represent the town of Simsbury.
Well, so. We're excited to see you enter the race, and obviously, I think. I've seen you work hard in the past, and I look forward to seeing you out there, getting to know residents,
yes,
you know, listening to
too.
Them, you know, making sure that folks feel comfortable to reach out to you, because you are extremely accessible. I know that, and really appreciate your willingness to continue to serve. And, you know, I think that goes often unsaid, but especially, you know, we raise our hand, you've raised your hand for public office,
mm-hmm.
and I don't think enough people say thank you for doing that. So thank mm-hmm. you. It's
No,
it's a hard thing
to do. It's a labor of love, but it's something that I feel very passionate about.
Mm-hmm.
And public service has always been in my family's blood and in the genes, and it continues with my children. And it's mm-hmm. I grew up in this state. I was born and raised in this state of Connecticut, and Simsbury is my home. And even though my children are in other parts of the country, Simsbury is still their home.
Yep.
And we understand. You know, what is going on in the state today, and I'm still very, very proud to be a resident of the state of Connecticut,
right.
and a resident of Simsbury.
Right. Well, Lydia, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank
We're just
you
about
very
out
much,
of time.
Sean.
The half an hour always goes by too fast, but
yes, it certainly
we
does.
Enjoy these great conversations, and this was one of my favorites. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes,
I'm honored.
Thank you for your service. Thank you to be here.
So make sure you go out and see our friend Lydia on the campaign trail and ask her questions and get to know her better as we know her. And don't forget to vote on the budget referendum on June 7th is an important day because we all worked so hard on that budget. And thank you again for tuning in for another edition of Community Conversations. We'll see you next time.
Funding for Simsbury Community Television is provided in part by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.